He told me I had stage four. It hit me like a ton of bricks. I blocked everything out. I heard nothing else. He said, I was told most people don't even make it 2 years. He started me on the chemo. It's not working. He said, but I got something else I'm gonna try. This NIH trial medication. And the results were amazing. I probably wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the NIH. This is what I truly believe. God and the NIH is why I'm here talking to you right now.
Mr. Grafton, I just really want to thank you for inviting me to your home to have this conversation. I know this is going to take a lot of courage for you to share your story, but I really believe that it's going to be helpful for everyone who hears it. All lung cancer patients, people who currently have lung cancer, and people who might find out that they have a diagnosis of lung cancer. I want to begin by having you tell us a little bit about yourself.
Oh, we got to go back that far. I grew up right here in Durham on the West End, which is Lakewood area, Chapel Hill Street area, all around. Everything was centered around Duke. And I guess that's how I became a big Duke fan. And I played basketball when I graduated from Durham High School. It was 8 kids in my family, 4 boys, 4 girls. My fondest memory, if I go back, is receiving that basketball scholarship to go to North Carolina Central University and my mother standing beside me. Because she's never been to one of my games, but she's always been there to support me. Now I'm trying to hold this together because I'm going back down memory lane. But seeing her, that look on her face, looking up at me, being one of the proudest moments of her life, is seeing her son walk across that stage and receiving that scholarship. So that's my memory.
That is a beautiful memory to share with us.
I got two boys and my granddaughter. So that's my life, which is the kids and Duke University.
Tell me now about, you know, how you found out, when you found out you had lung cancer. What was that like for you?
Okay, how I found out, I kept getting tired all the time. I was exhausted. I couldn't go up them steps without, I had to sit down. And then at night when I was trying to sleep, I couldn't breathe. So I had my son. That night, I said, we went to the clinic on Hillendale, and then they sent me to do the CAT scan, and that's when I met Dr.
Crawford. Yeah.
And he told me I had stage 4. It hit me like a ton of bricks. I blocked everything out. I heard nothing else. He said, all I heard was that stage 4. Once I heard that, I don't know what else was said in that room. I don't even know who was in that room. Because I said, you know the stories. My life is over. I'm done. So after that, he started me on the chemo. When I came back to see him, he said, it's not working. I'm like, this can't be happening. Mm-hmm. And he said, but I got something else I'm going to try. It's up to you, though. So I wasn't willing to try anything, everything. So that's when we started the trial medication, and the results were amazing to me. Mm. You know, each time I came back, that's when you came into the picture because right. He retired.
Right.
And
I took over.
You took over. And then you started showing me on screen, you know, how it was shrinking and holding, and I felt like living again.
Very good.
You know, and then this NIH, you know, the trial medication, I'm like, wow, if this trial stuff works for me, God knows what it'll do for somebody else. I probably wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the NIH. And I truly believe that. This is not a line. This is not trying to please some cameras or other people. This is a fact. This is what I truly believe. God and the NIH is why I'm here talking to you right now.
You talked about the side effects that you had from the chemotherapy that you had. What are the differences you had while on the trial versus when you were on the chemotherapy? Could you highlight a little bit of those?
For me, chemo, the side effects, man, I couldn't leave the house after I came from the hospital. The shortness in breath, the not being able to seem like function, going to the bathroom, I had to stay close. It was just draining. I don't wish that on nobody. I really don't. And I said, if this is what I got to go through, am I going to continue to go through this? So I see why some people said it's not worth it. But the alternative for me, I like living. I like living more than anything. And compared to the trial medication and the chemo, it's like night and day. The trial medication allowed me to dance again. I couldn't do that because it couldn't go anywhere. I was scared to go anywhere because of the side effects. But that trial, I could laugh. I felt like I was living. My life was back. I felt like I had it back. And like I said, I pray to God that somebody wakes up and don't stop this fun. Because without it, I truly don't believe I would be here today. I really don't.
I do want to touch on, you know, you mentioned about the side effects of chemotherapy. And that's something I hear a lot from patients. Chemotherapies are they're hard medications, right? They're tough on the body. They're in there to kill your cancer cells. But like you said, leaving is important. Many years ago, all we had was chemotherapy. As we advanced our knowledge through research, scientific findings, we're trying to move more and more away from chemotherapy into using things like immunotherapy and also targeted therapies in lung cancer. And this is the reason why research is so important. If we didn't have research, we wouldn't be where we are today without the research findings and just the clinical trial findings. I'm sure not just myself, but a lot of other physicians and researchers out there are really concerned about the potential cuts for research funding. What are your concerns for future patients who may not be able to have these studies available to them?
I'm lost at words for that one, because without this funding, like I said, I just truly believe I wouldn't be here today. And we need this. It's more than ever. People lies, man. This is, it's no matter whether you're young, old. I mean, who else behind these cuts? You need to come out there and see some of them people sitting out there at the hospital. Really. People need to really examine this thing and understand that if it's something that can be cured, something that can keep somebody here, keep them going, man, y'all got to keep this funding going. You really got to keep it going. This shirt I'm wearing, it's a car club I'm in. We are sponsoring a cruise in where you drive up and you give donations, and hopefully we can get some more pamphlets on cancer awareness and enlighten people on getting checked. You know, this thing has hit me in ways that I never thought would. I'm trying to do my part while I can, as long as I can, to support in any way anybody that is going through cancer.
I do want to reinforce the importance of screening. That is the first thing that saves lives, screening and early detection for lung cancer. So tell me, you mentioned at your first visit, you were told you had stage 4 lung cancer. Were you given a prognosis at that time at all?
Well, I was told that most people don't even make it 2 years. And I'm 2 years. Yes, I'm 2 years right now, as a matter of fact.
Yes, you've mentioned that this trial really gave you back your life. Have there been other lifestyle changes that you had to make since your diagnosis?
Yeah, I was weighing 320, 325. I lost 75 pounds. And it went just like that. It was a change. It was a big change. And then the eating habits, definitely had to change those to keep the numbers where you like them. And now I'm back on track. I know I am. Because I can feel it and I can tell it in the way I act and the things that I can do. So, yeah, I'm on track.
We have many more, I hope, many more years going forward, even after you leave the trial. And just being here in your house really makes me feel like a part of your family. And I just want to thank you. It's really a privilege to be a part of your journey, your story, being invited to know who you are. And just be a part of everything going for you is an honor to any oncologist, I'll tell you. Are there any words that you have to share to your family or to other cancer patients?
My support system, like I said, has been my family. That's what got me through it. And the family members, the friends, speaking out at functions that I go to, just getting up there, taking the mic, asking people to go get checked, and people say, I didn't know. And they say, you would never know by the way you act and carry yourself. Well, you know, it's a process. It's a journey. As long as I can see that light, as they say at the end of the tunnel, I'm going to keep going. I'm not giving up. I never will. I never, ever.
And you should not.
Will give up. You will never hear me say, this is it. I'm going to go lay down. I'm ready to go. No, you don't hear me say that. No. When my time comes, it's just my time. But you won't hear me say I'm ready to go. I'll be like, give me one more day. So that's what's happening with me. And I'm enjoying spending time with my granddaughter, who stays in my pocket. And we're taking all my little change. But it's worth it. It's worth it. You know, I like to pray to God that I'll be around to see her walk across that stage when it's time for her to graduate. So, yeah, that's it for me.
Thank you again for this time. I know this story is going to give a lot of hope to many other patients. And I just want to reiterate again that it's truly been an honor to be a part of your journey.
Thank you for having me. Thank you to the Duke staff. God knows. Thank y'all.
Research is not just about science. It's about people, like you. Discover the impact of research. Be sure to like and subscribe for the latest.